don't sound so excited, Raven. Frody and TJ are back on the caster desk. What are you staring at? What does TJ see over yonder in this, beyond the horizon?
I see Aggro Shaman.
I was thinking the four mana seven. You're doing a really good job. I wanted you to do get Jeff Goldblum and do the dinosaurs. You know, just talk about it in the four mana seven. But it's okay. The memes are a little bit weak in this one, but it's fine. Welcome back, everybody, to the Casting Desk. It's time to begin the second half of the broadcast. If you can't tell, I'm really excited because TJ's back with me. Raven did mention it already. We have IQLU up against BabbleBox. BabbleBox came earlier today in his first series. Was not able to qualify. English are hard, TJ. But now he has another chance up against IQLU. Now, I'm a little bit sad that Warrior keeps getting banned because some of these Warrior variants are actually really freaking cool.
Yeah, and this is a little bit of a weakness for BabbleBox. So if you remember earlier, BabbleBox's lineup is teched against Warrior. In his Aggro Shaman, he doesn't run Lightning Storm. So his plan was most likely to ban Zoo when he was coming into this, if he was the base popular lineup. But IQLU has a control warrior, like you mentioned, with still got the Slitherer. So it sort of throws a wrench in his plan because his decks are teched against more aggressive warriors or a little bit faster warriors. But he realizes that all of his decks are pretty weak to soak out the Slitherer in a control style. So all of them automatically right off the bat, BabbleBox is sort of at a tech disadvantage.
I just want to see Sogoth one time. A lot of players brought him to this tournament, and yet he keeps getting banned all the time because it fits in that control warrior slot. And so many people are just like, you know, I don't want to play against warrior. And as a result, we don't see it. Makes me feel a little disappointed, TJ.
All right, well, Hoy brought three, and I don't think he won.
Didn't he put four?
Was it four?
He put one in his Reno Warlock, one in his Control Warrior, one in his Druid, did he?
Yeah, but then he had...
he had a Control Shaman. Did he? I don't know if he put it in there.
I don't think he put it in the Control Shaman.
Turns out you can't put Ancestral Spirit on Sogoth the Slither, which is a little unfortunate. That'd be really cool if you could.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about the remaining decks. And based off of the inspection of the classes, it looks like it's actually a lineup mirror outside of that. They have similar classes and very similar archetypes. It's Zoo Warlock, the Aggressive Shaman, and the Token Druid featuring Yogg-Saron.
There are some striking differences, though, mainly with the Shamans and with the Warlocks. IQLU is running a double Doomguard with a Sea Giant version, which is better in the Zoom Mirror because a lot of times the board tends to get flooded, and Doomguard is much better than Leeroy because it helps you fight for board a little bit better than Leeroy, and BabbleBox is running the Leeroy version. Also, as I mentioned earlier, there's no Lightning Storm in his Shaman deck.
Sure.
So he's going to be a little bit worse in the Mirror matchups and in the Zoo matchups. So I think that BabbleBox is at a little bit of a disadvantage here. But the decks at their core are still strong. So it's pretty even game.
Yeah, don't really count any of these players out. But there's one thing that is for certain, that these guys are very ready to go, because BabbleBox has been very close before, but it just takes another level of concentration when you get close in the first round of the final round, and then you lose and you come back. IQLU, by the way, has some notoriety in the Hearthstone community scene. I think a lot of people may have seen his name, perhaps finish high on ladder multiple times, or even seen some of his decks that he posts and guides. I don't really think too many people associate things with him, though, specifically compared to some of the other players who always share their decks.
Yeah.
You see guys like Crusher, for example, or you see guys like Loyan share his deck list, and that's when you kind of see, like, oh, they had a really good run on Legend Ladder. Like, these are the guys that we associate to. IQLU does that, but I don't think many people really remember that, unfortunately.
The decks that he creates are just different variations of decks that are already really good. That's just sort of, it tends to be forgotten sometimes, but definitely someone who's not an unknown by any means, I suppose.
At least to us. Yeah. He's also Polish, which means that Nimsh never stops talking about him, and it is true. Nimsh always reminds me of the great players in Poland, like, himself, Lothar, IQLU, Johnny Druid, there's a bunch of other people.
Himself.
Himself, again. Actually, Nimsh doesn't even talk about himself. He really likes to talk about the Polish scene and how they're coming up. They did pretty well in the recent DreamHacks, too, the Polish team.
Yeah. I believe he's actually casting this stream in Polish right now.
Yeah. So, I guess you just remove the Voidwalker. The hero power is not really that applicable here in this situation.
It's a pretty rough draw early on for Bellbox, especially since he's stuck with a thing from below and he gave up his hero power, which is going to make it so that the best he can do is find a Totem Golem or a Tuskar Totemic to try and make that a little bit cheaper.
Yeah, the only thing is that he's just allowing his opponent to get free development onto the board here. Mm-hmm. And if his opponent traded up with either Direwolf Alpha or an Abusive Sergeant, it just feels like Battlebox would be really far behind. Because when Zoo gets the board, it's really difficult for the Shaman to clear everything. They can clear some of those things. And Doomhammer is one of those really valuable things.
Doomhammer allows you to have sort of a secondary resource, and that is your health, where you can take a bunch of damage but remove things every turn, which sort of makes up for the resource advantage that Zoo Warlock usually has.
Okay. Flame Juggler. That is a minion that you can play, and in the worst case scenario, and you hit the 2/4, you actually can remove it with the Rockbiter weapon, so it's not too bad.
Can't backfire as much as it usually can.
Yeah, and you still keep the Sir Finley Murgleton onto the board. He is a gentleman and a scholar and an adventurer. He is the complete package, ladies.
He also has a tiny machete. Wow. He really is the complete package.
It's not the size that matters, TJ. It's the size of the fight in the Murloc. I messed it up. It's not the size of the Murloc in the fight, TJ. It's the size of the fight in the Murloc.
Unless one has machete.
And a monocle. TJ, you could use a monocle. You would look 10 times smarter than you already do.
Thanks, Dan.
Yeah, it's a compliment. You look brilliant.
Not so sure about that.
At least get the safari hat.
I already have one.
Why are we not dressing up according to the themes of the expansions? That's what I want to know. Why aren't the rest of you dressing up? I clearly partied last night in Karazhan, as you can tell by my disheveled hair and my off-centered bow tie. But you guys, I'm going to take you guys wardrobe shopping after this event.
I planted a chia pet into my head. Do you know what a chia pet is?
It's the thing that grows to leaves things.
Yeah.
I just remember the little catch song. Chia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they played that at Karazhan last night.
You're such a liar. I just want you to dress in a safari hat when we play League of Explorers. But, I mean, the League of Explorers is almost done and dusted with. Feels like the Faceless has to come down this turn. If you play Argent Horse Rider, it just trades poorly onto the board, and it does mess up your mana curve, but at least you can still play the Horse Rider next turn. It's okay.
He's actually very close to being able to just straight up kill it and trade up to it. And I don't know, maybe he thought that he had enough, but I think this play might have taken a little bit more consideration.
Yeah.
Because this play's a little bit off curve, forces him either to trade in or let this Flame Wraith get a lot more value than it seemed like he was originally intending it to.
It's okay if you trade awkwardly like this. The only thing is I felt like maybe you could have played Defender of Argus.
Yeah.
Get the value while you can. There is like a couple of things that people do have, like they have a couple of rules. And one of the things about Zoo is that the principle they try to follow is if you can get Defender of Argus value in a matchup where early board is very volatile, you try to get double value, like in Zoo matchup specifically too. That's like a huge thing too. Like Zoo versus Zoo, you try to get double Defender Argus value. So normally the time that you try to set up Doomhammer is when you can answer things onto the board. It's not exactly the cleanest setup though. So is it the time to play Doomhammer or not, TJ?
Well, his other plays are fairly weak. Thing from Below. Not Journey from Below. Thing from Below has the potential to get answered if I Kill You has any sort of buff card with Darkshire Councilman because of the way that it gets buffed up. Now, it would bait that trade in, but also you'd be punished by Power Overwhelming, and you get punished by a lot of things. Doomhammer allows you to kill the Abuse Sergeant and go face, or you could also damage the Darkshire Councilman twice and only take two damage in order to hit it next turn to try and clear the board. But again, that's quite risky. So, yeah, I guess, okay, he's going to damage it once. This is sort of, middle ground. It doesn't feel good, but I believe it's the best option he had given the circumstances.
Yeah, I don't really like Totem Golem. I don't like just the six mana thing from below. You can decrease the cost of thing from below through the two totems in your hand, despite the fact that you no longer have the Call Totem hero power. But this is where it starts getting really awkward, to say the least. How do you now remove the Darkshire Councilman, which just got a plus six permanent buff, and you got these six little disgusting tentacle things staring at you? Mm-hmm.
And no Lightning Storm, keep in mind, in Babblebox's aggressive shaman list. So no way to effectively deal with these 1/1s.
Ouch.
And Sea Giant's going to come out for so cheap next turn.
Is he just like dead by any chance if you play Defender of Argus and Direwolf Alpha?
Six. Yes.
Direwolf.
No, he doesn't have room.
He can trade one in and get plus five. Yeah, he actually has lethal if he trades
five,
one in.
Six, seven, you eight, just, nine. That's
just
correct.
Push one of the 1/1s in and then you have lethal.
Yeah. Exact lethal.
There you go. So one of those little cute lethals, but not the most mind-blowing ones for IQLU. And that should wrap up the first game. There you go. Very nice. There you go. And I think that's just like a really important thing that he's able to lead off with the win, because you have to kind of figure out what's the weak link in the series. Actually, you know, I take that back. The weak link in the series might actually be Druid, because the Druid struggles against the other two classes the most. Mm-hmm. I was thinking Zoom might be, or the Shaman. Might, but I think Druid is actually the biggest liability. So not the biggest end of the world for biggest deal for Babblebox now that Druid's still available for both players.
Yeah, I think if you look at the lineup as a whole, Shaman's the weakest. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the lineup when you include bans, it feels like Druid's the weakest.
Right, right.
I mean, of course, it depends on whether or not you're bringing or what type of warrior you're bringing. But normally that's the case. So I definitely agree with that sentiment. But yeah, leading off with the win, definitely a good start. And it's hard to tell because that game was quick, but maybe the text from Battlebox's decks not matching up as well with IQLU's than it was against decks early in the tournament. Because being able to ban the Zoo in almost all of his other series up until this point, when he was facing lineups that were similar to his, might have given him an edge, because Zoo is the strongest deck when you look at these lineups side by side.
Okay.
And so now that he's forced to ban the Warrior because he just doesn't have a deck to deal with it, now he's all of a sudden becoming weak to this. He has to sort of give up a win to the Zoo Warlock a lot of the times, and it becomes a little bit awkward. I don't know. It's going to be tough.
Yeah, like Druid might be the weakest just on the paper, but it also can just beat anything. It's one of those decks that's very decent against the field in general, and it's capable of still coming back against most things. And you look at things like the Yogg-Saron effect, but it's mostly things like Innervate that really allows it to win against everything. I know Yogg-Saron is still very flashy, and people feel like, well, this card is a little bit too strong for what the variants that it brings. However, you have to look at the overarching game plan of Druid. We're not going to get there just yet. Babblebox is choosing to stay on the Shaman. IQLU playing his own Shaman. This matchup is extremely volatile, in my opinion. I think it goes so back and forth, and the person that's able to play with a lot of initiative is the one that's going to be at a huge advantage.
What do you think of the Tuskar Totemic Keep in the Mulligans, Dan?
On the coin, it's okay, because you're expecting to answer a turn one play through the Tunnel Trog, and then you coin Tuskar Totemic. I'm not in love with it, but I think he's mulliganing with like pessimism in mind, because he doesn't want to be stuck with just like removal. Sometimes you just have like lightning bolts and lava bursts. So his play ends up being okay, especially now that he's picked up more options.
Given his lineup, I actually don't like it that much. Given his deck list, because he runs more early drops than average because of cutting Lightning Storm, and I think he cut out something from the later on the list, but I can't quite remember what it was yet. Like he runs Flame Juggler, he runs like Totem Golem, so you'd rather have Flame Juggler, you'd rather have Totem Golems, you'd rather have Argent Squires, you'd rather have Abusive Sergeants. I don't know. It's a little bit interesting, but I get what you mean. If you get all removal, then you're in a really bad spot because it's about the board, and you want to build a board and remove.
So. I tend to agree that I come from the school of thought that you have to be optimistic with some of your mulligans if you're playing aggressive, because if you have some of these suboptimal responses, then you're at best going to have a suboptimal response. Mm-hmm. So if you're keeping things like Swipe and Wrath and you're not really trying to go for Innervate and Wild Growth, you're not going to get those explosive turns. You're stuck hoping your opponent has the best possible scenarios, and then you might get awkward situations where they don't have the best response, and then your hand's weaker. But, I mean, BattleBox did pick up these two one-mana minions regardless of it. IQ also doesn't really have anything on turn three. He's got removal, and, well, two things from below means that every hero power makes his swing turn very strong, so he's not out of it just yet.
He will be able to Rockbiter this turn into a thing from below the following turn into a Doomhammer on curve, which is incredibly strong if you can afford to utilize your health to start clearing off the board. Then you can put yourself in a really good position in this matchup, which at least for the first six or seven turns comes down to the board.
All right, let's see what Tusker Totemic has got concocting in his whatever he's cooking up. What is even between the hands of Tusker Totemic? Is that just his belly?
I wonder.
Don't know.
It's some sphere of mystical, magical powers.
Yep.
TJ's going to look up the art real quick while we fathom what it's going to be. Or is it time to play the Tuskar Totemic? Or sorry, not the Tuskar Totemic, the Flaming Faceless, because you can coin that out. You will be only on two mana, though. That is the challenge. What I like about Tuskar Totemic is that you play that. You play the Flaming Faceless, and then the following turn, you can coin the Doomhammer.
He's just sort of has a totem in front of him coming out of the earth.
Oh, so he's like pulling it out. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what totem will he pull from the ground?
It's weird, yeah.
There it is. And it is his belly.
The totem golem.
Tusker Totemic. Wow.
Literally pulled a totem golem out of the earth.
Yikes. I was about to say that Tusker Totemic should hit the gym, but if he's pulling totem golems, he can do whatever he pleases. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. IQLU more likes is more saying, please kill me right now. Yeah. Because he's facing off against the exact worst situation that he's always imagining, which is Tusker Totemic summoning totem golem.
Yeah. He does have a spell power totem on the board, which means he can answer the totem golem with lightning bolt. But answering the secondary effect of a 3-drop with a spell that means you can't play your Doomhammer on curve next turn is not a great feeling. So I think from below, I believe it's a must in this situation.
Yeah, the only alternative line was to Lightning Bolt 1, like the Totem Golem, and then Hero Power, so you can reduce the cost of Thing from Below. Next turn, you would have another opportunity to do the same exact thing. It's very weak, though. You're very far behind on board. Your opponent gets free development. And BattleBox, I mean, he could just trade into this and play his Flame Beneath Faces. He also can still coin that Doomhammer out and have, like, a very decisive board to control, so that way he can play whatever 3-mana play that he has next turn, such as the Argent Horse Rider or the Feral Spirits. I kind of like that better, so giving his options more flexible. It's not really about the 4-mana 7-7. It's a lot of times about board control in this matchup. Wow, choosing to take 10 damage. That's how much he values his health. Almost nothing.
Yeah, I think this is almost directly caused by him having Feral Spirit, or else his traits would have been a lot different. He realizes that he is going to be able to taunt up and want as strong of a board as possible, so Doomhammer won't punish him nearly as much. But imagine if IQLU had Lightning Storm, which BattleBox saw IQLU totem up on the first two turns with an aggressive Shaman deck. So that means he has situational cards. I don't know. I think it's a little bit risky in a mirror matchup like this to use your health all willy-nilly.
I'm inclined to agree. If IQLU also had more burn, let's say he had Rockbiters and lightning bolts and stuff. So then all of a sudden the tone changes a lot. He's running out of time, though. Both players playing really defensive, and now all of a sudden, one's choosing to be aggressive, and he did pick up more burn. Okay. Do you want to use the thing from below here, or do you want to lightning bolt and be defensive that way?
I don't know. If you double lightning bolt, you can clear the board, but be down to 10 and push what? 2 damage.
You hero power, which means you get thing from below down to 3. So next turn, you can play thing from below. You can hero. You can play Tuskar
and thing from below.
And thing from below.
Yeah.
Reasonable. Not exactly the most desirable of situations. Oh, there is this possibility that Battlebox doesn't kill him, which doesn't look like it is the case. And if Akili picks up the Rockbiter and his opponent doesn't kill that spell power totem, that is the game,
wow,
DJ.
That was incredibly dramatic.
That is our job as the commentators, man. Akili's no longer has it, but maybe Thing from Below can introduce a big enough roadblock. Oh man, I don't know about this.
It's going to have to.
No, I think that might be it here. Oh, wait, the Taunt Totem.
Taunt Totem introduces an extra variable.
No, he still has lethal because he has Flame Tongue Totem and Horse Rider. So he uses the first attack through the Doom Hammer, and then he just uses this to push through.
Yeah.
I think, if I'm counting that correctly.
Yeah, because the Flame Tongue Totem will also buff the Flame Wreath Faceless up. So you can Flame Tongue Totem, Horse Rider, the Thing from Below for 4.
Yep.
Then use the Doom Hammer. Doom Hammer the Stone Claw Totem and attack base for 9.
Yes. There is a way to mess this up too if Battlebox does it incorrectly. But if he spots it, the game is his. It is your birthright to take this game. Do it.
He's summoning his brain power.
What to do? Maybe he's all talk and no brain.
Don't worry, Lux.
Being
the
a battle box.
Brain power, attend me.
There you go. He's got it. He's got it. Ready, sir. I guess at this point, I kill you is not really that surprised, given that he passed his first 2 turns essentially after the tunnel truck. Didn't really have much to do afterwards, and that's usually a recipe for disaster. It's very hard to come back from that situation. But the fact that he almost could is just showing you how strong the Shaman deck is. You almost came back from that terrible start from the game.
And with Shaman being sort of that volatile element of this deck lineup, I want to call it the most inconsistent out of a lineup of 3. I mean, sort of the lesser of the 3 evils. Taking the mirror matchup is incredibly important, because if you lose a mirror matchup when you're down 0-1, it puts you in a very awkward position. Especially with Druid left remaining, that gives you gives IQ 3 opportunities to win with Druid, which is not what you want, being it's probably the strongest deck when given multiple chances because of its consistency.
Yeah, that's why a lot of people save Druid for last in general. But you have to kind of imagine that both these players are just being very conservative, and we are a little bit poking fun at them for taking their time. But if you have the time, I say take it. If I'm in their seats, I know I would definitely take the time and rope out and make sure I count everything. You can see these guys, they've been playing for hours continuously, and it's just to be sitting there mentally engaged for a long time does end up making it a little bit taxing. And then sometimes when you play for a long time over the course of a couple days, some of the games start blending together. You start thinking, oh, did he use both of his copies of this one card? Did I use this copy? Am I fishing for the wrong card by cycling certain things? You have to be on point. Speaking of being on point, look at this hand from the Druid. Jeez, that is very explosive. Now, it all can go terribly if his opponent has a power overwhelming. But do you still, does that dissuade you from doing anything?
Your opponent is not mulliganing for power overwhelming. So if you're going to make a play like this, turn 1 is the best time to do it, because it's the least likely that your opponent will have power overwhelming in their hand. And he does have a pretty decent setup. The only thing is, he'll have one sort of floating turn, Going into turn two, he would have an innervate, a one drop, and a nourish for five. So we'd have to wait another turn before he say innervate, nourish. But he would have the Raven Idol. He could have one mana left over to maybe pick up a Living Roots or even another Raven Idol to generate additional token.
Raven Idol could be anything, DJ.
Could even be a Raven Idol or a boat.
A boat in a box, really, Peter? I don't know. Innervate, Violet Teacher, without the Raven Idol, chooses to keep hold on to the Innervate. I can get behind this play. You're, like you said, the only reasonable thing to expect is a double Abusive Surgeon. And in this case, Battlebox doesn't have it. Shakes his head, realizing that this is the match that he wants to win. No, he needs to win. And at this point, Battlebox is, you know, inside his head, just thinking about what are the best ways to handle this pressure, if any.
Yeah, inside his babble box.
Woo, I like it. Maybe maybe he is babble box personified. Mm-hmm.
But it's a stressful situation.
He should be a caster. He has a great username for it.
Yes, he does.
Get in there and fight. He probably will be at one point.
Every player goes down there.
Yeah, apparently we're hiring. I guess you trade into it, but it doesn't feel like a very high chance that Violet Teacher just willingly goes down like this. I think what it is anticipation that the Direwolf Alpha can get picked up and then trade into it that way. I'm ready to
learn. It's going to go ahead and Wild Growth and Innervate out.
But the value has been grabbed. You know, it absorbs some damage. It's trading into some minions. It's generating some 1-1 tokens. So Violet Teacher, by all means, has not been useless. A lot of people would feel like, man, I just lost that Teacher and I only have 1-1s remaining. But those 1-1s are very relevant. Especially if your opponent is forced to play off-curve right now with the Direwolf Alpha and trade into the Violet Teacher, which seems to be the case. I would not advocate for the Knife Juggler to come out.
Well,
I'm also
if he's feeling bold,
hesitant to just play the Darkshire Councilman because of the fear of a Violet Teacher being buffed up, man. It'd be too scary.
Sometimes when you're on a big stage like this and everything's on the line,
yeah,
you got to take some risks, Dan.
It's true.
But is a risk like Knife Juggler one that you're willing to take?
I would probably say that the benefits of Knife Juggler is that you have a 75% chance of killing something on the board.
Yeah.
So it's a very high chance.
For the actual sports fans out there, I'll put it as an analogy. Going for Knife Juggler right here would be like in a basketball game, if you're down 2 points, going for the winning full court shot, but you still have 45 seconds left remaining in the game.
And so many people have done that kind of play in the past, man.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Violet Teacher going down, though, absolutely the right thing. Ooh, interesting. So Savage Roar here. I was trying to think about the implications of it, because then he can Savage Roar protect the token. But I guess he feels like the token's not worth protecting anyways. Astral Communion, of course. A lot of people look at that card, TJ, and they think, what would I do with an Astral Communion anyways? Ditch my hand. Not worth it.
Well, Naaman at Seat Story Cup with a Yogg Druid deck.
Yeah.
Played Astral Communion.
Yeah, not all of us have the bravery of Kazakhstanian men. And Naaman did end up winning that game because he played Astral Communion off of Raven Idol.
Yes.
Then he proceeded to draw Nourish off the top into Yogg-Saron into a second Nourish. And it was the most amazing game that I saw of that tournament. That was crazy.
But alas, this game is not that game.
This game's not that game, but Force of Nature being played is still relevant. You know, the 2/2s do challenge most things. There's a lot of 2-health minions in the zoo, so yeah, it's a very reasonable assumption that you can either kill off the Darkshire Councilman or have relevance. How good is a swipe in this position? It actually
fantastic.
Helps you clear the entire board.
And be left with your trees still.
Yeah, you actually left with both of your trees.
Whoa.
Okay. Perhaps he wants to go for a bigger swing turn with the Nourish. I still think Swipe is pretty good. Perhaps he's really afraid of the Forbidden Ritual follow-up. A lot of times, very commonly, you see that Forbidden Ritual. Okay, he's always ramping. Okay, so he gets that extra hero power.
Okay, well,
Okay, so he has Azurix Swipe next turn.
Yeah, he has Azurix Swipe next turn, and he's setting himself up to be able to play much further ahead in the mana curve than the zoo. So trying to make up for the resource advantage in that regard. But now he loses an important tool with Nourish.
Yeah.
And that's catching up on resources.
It's catching up on resources, which Druid does tend to struggle with against the Zoo Warlock, primarily because Warlock's tapping and they have two cards per turn. And also, he doesn't fully clear. So Power Whelming actually kills off this Azure Drake, and he just uses Swipe. So Aikilu's going to try to rely on this Ancient of War, but it's not nearly as good of a position as it could be. You know, ideally as a druid, you get a decisive, very squeaky clean board, but it's not going to be the case here.
Well, there's the Acidic Swamp who's coming out. Could be good, really good against Shaman, but the thing is, he built the lineup to have at least two out of three weapon classes being available to play against with that ooze in his deck. And we talked about before being handicapped. Ooze is not a great two drop, I should say, in Zoo.
Okay, so we're looking for Doom Guards, looking for Power Overwhelmings. Flame Imp is not it. In fact, Imp is a little bit scary to play. Fenrir's isn't that bad.
You can buy him time to draw into something to help get through this Ancient of War more easily, because he is started running out of health, so if he didn't have a way to block this
my shield
damage, IQ, you would have the option of just starting to push face damage and putting a clock on him.
Okay, it's a very big board, and that's a very big old god to play later on. He doesn't have to play it just yet, but the fact that he has Yogg-Saron might make him feel like, you know what, maybe I can just overextend because I'll probably draw the cards and clear the board. This also encourages him to play every single spell in his hand possible. Well, not Mulch, obviously, because he wants to save them for Doom Guards, but play these like two Panthers so that way he can get the Yogg-Saron Spirit Bomb going. Just charge it up.
Ooh.
Wait, what just happened? That is a lot of damage.
It is, but it's not nearly enough because he's at 24 with a 5-8 taunt. But
right.
What it is a way to help get through the Ancient of War if he thinks that he can afford using it. Of course, it's going to spawn the 1-1s. But does he think there's a way that he can make favorable trades? Now, either way, he's going to have to trade off most of his board. So maybe not the most effective draw, especially at this stage in the game. It's flashy, but not very effective.
So what Leeroy essentially helps you do is preserve the 3/2s, so that way you don't have to trade them in. But then the 3/2s get contested by your opponent's 3/2s. So it doesn't actually help preserve that much, because your opponent can get past through hero powers, even if they value trade. But then the problem is, when do you play Leeroy? Because if you're not playing it to remove a big target minion like that, you're just like really never going to play Leeroy until you finish. Oh, he's running out of time. He's got it. Clutch.
Well traded.
All right, so there is a hypothetical lethal for Aikilu. Also, I do like trading into one minion, hitting the face, and playing Yogg-Saron, because two minion targets are often the best, so that way cards like Cleave and Dark Bargain are also relevant.
But if you hit face with both, you just have to piece together 5 damage on Yogg to get there. And I kill you, there's the smile. I think that means he did it.
Okay.
But let's go ahead and see what happens.
Holy fire to the face?
No, of course.
Yeah. Oh.
Well, I guess he was kind of looking for a board clear.
Yeah, that's going to be the way to do it. Doesn't win, but it's still frozen.
All right. Oh, he's got it. There it is. Unless his opponent somehow gets a taunt, which I don't think so.
Is that possible?
I don't know. There probably has to be some way that your opponent gets summoned something through taunts. All right, now we're just going to wait for all the spells to finish. Essentially, Yogg doing his encore performance, but the Rockbiter should be enough, and that'll wrap up the game.
Yep, and unlike previous Yoggs that we've seen this tournament, that one was just used as basically a five damage finisher.
Ten mana, five damage. Than Ragnaros, or in this case, I guess what can you play as a druid that finishes off for five damage?
I mean, if you have a board, Cenarius.
Yeah, Cenarius
can be five damage if you have three or more minions. So, you know, he does have. I feel like he has a pretty greedy druid list. He's got a lot of top end, so. Any big mid drop in that situation would have effectively done the same thing, maybe just over two turns.
True. So let's go into game number four. Now, Akili only has to win with the Shaman remaining up against the Druid and the Warlock deck. And Akili is one step away from qualifying for the championship. And he's going to also deny Babblebox both of his chances of qualifying, which is heartbreaking.
Yeah. Akiliu is actually, he's been fighting through the lower bracket for a bit, so he's had a much tougher road to get to this stage. He's had to play against more opponents. Battlebox made it all the way through to until today through the upper bracket. So he had to beat about five opponents, but he beat some pretty good ones along the way. He beat 6-0, he beat Nyria, so he's knocked a few out of the tournament, but maybe now it's his time to be knocked out if Akiliu wills it to be so.
That's right. And we don't really get that many Polish representatives. We had Loyan, I believe, last season. But it's cool to see the diversity of the different countries coming into the championship as well. And I really want to see more of that happening. So let's go into game number four. See if IQU can go to the championship, get his first berth in HCT. Babblebox looking frazzled.
He's looking kind of exhausted. You saw him sort of like hit his head there, saying like, brain, like work now. And you mentioned it earlier, it can be exhausting, especially, I mean, yeah, you could say Battlebox didn't have to play as many matches, but he does have to sort of wait longer in between his matches is the thing. So that can be exhausting too. You're sitting there thinking about your next opponent, thinking about who could it be, you know, watching matches, and it's very exhausting, especially over a two-day tournament, especially with the hours that it takes to play a tournament of the scale. And so maybe starting to get a little bit exhausted. He looks fresh, though. He's like, hey, I've won like five Hearthstone matches already today. I'm ready to go.
Some people deal with stress in different ways. Some people rise up to the challenge. They enjoy it. The adrenaline gets pumping.
Yep.
They feel motivated. In fact, they perform better. Some people crumble. Some people feel like they can't really manage the stress. And I know there's times when I've sat in the player box, and all I can think about is just the cards that I'm looking at. I can't even abstract think about what my opponent's holding or what I even want to do. And then all of a sudden, time runs out and the rope's coming. You're like, I have to make a play. So you just make a play. And it's something really hard to describe until you actually sit there and compete. And you don't really expect it, because in other games, so take StarCraft, for example, or Heroes of the Storm, the action is very constant. So you're always doing something. Some of the most maddening things is when you're left to your own devices and you just have to think in silence. And it's just like, you're just left with time. And time sometimes makes you hesitate and mess up. Versus routine mechanics, you just do the same thing you've always done.
Yep.
Every single time. You do the same you box the same way, you click the same way, you click on the same things.
It's especially scary to me because I definitely don't want to be stuck with my own thoughts.
That makes two of us.
Nor does anybody in the world want to be stuck with my own thoughts.
That's right. So Akiliu chooses the Hunter Hero power. He did have the choice of Mage, which is interesting, so that way you can pick off some of your opponent's minions. It is very important to get board control, but the Hunter Hero power does a very important thing, which is shut off Life Tap, which is one of the best resources that Warlock has in any matchup.
I just want to point out something real quick, Dan. I know I've sort of harped on the Acidic Swamp Ooze tech choice today in Zoo, but I just want to go over a little bit more. It's not a reliable tool against anything other than Warrior. Because against anything other than Warrior, you're not playing the Acidic Swamp Ooze on curve. And with Zoo, you can't afford to have too many cards that sit dead in your hand. You notice there that Doomhammer is one of the most important cards in this matchup. And getting an Ooze on a Doomhammer can be pretty crucial. But the way Zoo works is that you just have to play out your minions, and you can't afford to hold on to Acidic Swamp Ooze until that time comes. So Acidic Swamp Ooze only becomes relevant in this matchup when you draw it at almost the perfect time. And I don't know, I feel like it's a pretty weak tech choice overall. I would like to ask him how it performed in his other matches, how many weapons he destroyed. the Chronicles of the Swamp Ooze, so to speak. A graphic novel presented by BattleBox itself.
Narrated by Morgan Freeman.
Narrated by Morgan Freeman.
I remember BattleBox.
Interpretive dance presented by Frodan.
Oh, am I a part of this production
as
well?
Yeah.
I'll have my agent call you.
Okay.
I did not agree to such terms.
But yeah, that's my point.
The light protects me.
I can definitely see your point, and I think a lot of people might just take the entire results package and feel that it's justified. So for example, I qualify for the championship. Perhaps this means that the Swamp Ooze is really good tech. It also could be one of those things where it just happened to be very powerful. And we've had players admit many times in the past that they've done very well, but yet it's a bad variant of the deck. Look no further than Jackie Chan, who experiments a ton with his decks. As you can guys see that, you're just gonna get the very easy power bombing train to kill you. He was not happy to see that. Really unhappy, but this is one of the things that Zoo just does. Have two power bombings for the perfect trades and the big things. But you know, Jackie, for example, was playing a control shaman with frost giants. And we're like, why do you play frost giants? Like, I don't know, I thought it was a good idea, but it's just bad. But he got second in the tournament. And the first thing he's like, I should just come back and change that control shaman because it's just a bad variant of the deck.
And so many people are out there still right now playing the control shaman with frost giants, and they're listening to Frodan right now, and they're like, why didn't anybody tell me?
I know, but you know, being able to analyze cards independently from the deck's performance is pretty important. Something that I know players like Chalky likes doing a lot. Mm-hmm. All right, Leroy Jenkins, he got all the aggressive cards in his first few draws here. He got both Powerful Whelming Soulfire and Leroy Jenkins.
Yeah. And Aikyu is, I mean, he's losing health pretty quickly, but definitely by no means in danger because you can't really leave a board up from Shaman and Go Face because they do have a reasonable amount of buff cards. Not as much as Zoo, but Flame Tongue Totems and Abusive Sergeants. So you definitely, and they can also hide things behind Feral Spirits, so you don't want to get too greedy or too aggressive, I suppose, is a better way to put that.
Yep.
And ignore the board.
Voodoo Doctor, pretty underrated one drop minion in matchups like these because it helps you restore health either on board or to your own face. And that ends up being pretty valuable a lot of the times when you're trying to get control of the board. You can extrapolate its theory, if you're assuming you're healing a minion, to become a 1-mana 2/3 if it heals two more health on a minion that you're trying to grab board control. In this case, it just offsets the Flame Imp to only deal 1 damage instead. And every little bit of health matters.
BattleBox is crossing his fingers for no Lightning Storm for the time being. And Aikyu is saying,
no, I mean, he's staying true to his name.
My friend, it's time. It's time to kill you.
What accent? What on earth was that?
That's how his name is spelled. I was trying to be.
Apparently, Aikyu is from North Carolina, playing in the Europe Summer Preliminary.
That was Antonio Banderas.
You killed my druid. Prepare to die. I don't really know if BattleBox has lethal right off the top. I'm counting 2, 4, 6, 10, 11, 17. That's very close. He doesn't have enough board space. He actually did have enough, but just if he could play 8 minions instead of 7.
There is an out for Aikyu, though. He will have 8 mana available next turn.
The second lava burst. So one draw out of the remaining 21 or so.
Well, when you put it that way.
He's got a less than 5% chance to succeed. So 94% of the time, BattleBox will win this game. Is that what you're telling me, TJ?
Exactly. We'll see.
96% of the time, I apologize. Because Lightning Storm wouldn't even save him here in this position, I think.
Nothing would spawn from the game boss.
Oh, you're right. You could kill the thing. Lightning Storm was another out then.
You could attack it, and then you'd have to. You wouldn't have to roll high on the Defender Vargas. You'd be in decent shape. So
yeah, you'd be fine.
Lightning Storm would have been an out, probably a game winner. But for the time being, it looks like that's not going to be enough. I think BattleBox will have enough to push through.
Yeah, if he was going to use Lava Burst on the in-game boss, he should have used it before he traded, like you mentioned, so the 1-1 doesn't remain. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Yeah, a little bit of an awkward situation, I think.
It's one of those times where you swallow your pride and do it anyway, even if it's a mistake. I know a lot of players, myself included, if I forget to sequence something earlier on in the match, it's not worth it. I just hold on to it, even if it's going to lose me a game.
It's not worth it, TJ. Don't admit the mistake. Yeah. You already have a one-game lead, and this game is kind of out of your grasp.
This decision is not if he wants to lava burst or not.
It's Correct line. Because if we don't have our pride as Hearthstone pro gamers, TJ, then what are we?
Yeah. I mean, the tens of thousands of people watching him know that that would have been a misplay. But the important part is that BattleBox wouldn't.
Yes.
And so I kill you.
It's
well
true.
Done.
It's true. I mean, almost any way the trade's gone down, I believe Leroy was lethal or one off, which
regardless.
Is very easy to pick up as the Zoo player. So, all things considering, IQ, you made the right play, in my opinion. Of course, this is all, we're being facetious. Of course, IQ, you would have preferred to use the Lava Burst in the right situation. But, you're also just trying to think of, what are the outs? If I use Lava Burst in this situation, can I still win? Because, no, he's at 9 HP, so you have to draw 7 damage from one card. Very unlikely. It was a tough position, or top prop position, regardless.
And now it comes down to game number 5. Again, I feel like we've had a lot of matches sort of play out in a similar fashion. Today, and the last match is going to come down to Druid versus Shaman.
That's right.
And although
that's not a bad hand for the Druid.
Yeah. I'd like to look at the stats from this matchup across this tournament specifically, with most players knowing that both of these decks would be popular. Because
I think that might be possible. Give me a sec.
Okay. Because a lot of players think that the Shaman is favored. Because there are big taunts in Druid, but they don't come until much later in the game. And Shaman can really get ahead of the board, considering Wrath and Living Roots don't usually deal with the early minions from Shaman as well as they do from, say, Zoo. Wrath doesn't line up against Totem Call very well, so sometimes they can get off to a great start. But I feel like this tournament, at least the games that we've watched on stream, Druid has performed pretty well against Shaman. Getting early ramp, getting boards that are really tough to deal with. But overall, the matchup is fairly close, as is with most of the matchups that we've seen across the day today.
I don't really see any statistics that are put up by our brackets. I believe we do use the Battlefy brackets to showcase people publicly, as well as to the participants who their next opponents are. I believe we'll have to wait till the end to find a conclusion to some of these statistics. But I do know that Shaman's been getting increasingly an edge over Druid. Now, keep in mind that BattleBox has the ramp hand dream, essentially. You know, he can continue to ramp into more ramp into more ramp into play whatever he wants and draws. But he's also got he's got no substance to what he has in his hand. His best minion to control the board is Mire Keeper. And that is not saying much.
He's got a grill. He's got the seasonings. He's got a flame. He even has an apron with a little heart on it.
That's my apron. He stole it from me.
But he doesn't have any meat.
Well, BattleBox at this point choosing to coin Wild Up Growth just because he needs to do something. It's a really hard call to make, because you could also justify passing Wild Growth, using the coin flexibly for whether or not you want to remove or coin to something that's really on an odd number. There's really powerful minions that are on odd numbers. So, like the Azure Drake, for example, or the Ancients of War. Those are all like valid things that you can use for the coin, so that way you can save it. But in this case, BattleBox just really wants to get the Wild Growth out of the way.
You can see IQ's face once that second Wild Growth came out. He's like, oh no. He said, this one is going to be tough. Because even though your opponent's using these resources, they're using cards to get this ramp, which means they don't have other cards that could possibly be removal spells or big minions that they can play.
Right.
But that being two men ahead is very scary, because it means they can play pretty much whatever they draw from the game on out.
Right. But then here's another question, too. Does Druid have the tempo tools to come back? If he plays Flamey Faces next turn, how does he deal with that? Another thing to consider is that Babblebox hesitated before he made this coin Wildgrowth into Wildgrowth play, which implies that he doesn't have a 5-mana play. Usually, if you coin Wildgrowth into a Wildgrowth again, it's because you're trying to line up your mana awkwardly, so that way you could use your 5-mana very efficiently. But Babblebox planned for a draw to help him use it efficiently, and that's what really made the play a little bit awkward, because now he'd much rather be in a position where he could just use his Wrath or use a Swipe and then have that coin flexibly for cards like Violet Teacher on the following turn. However, he still has to do something. I don't mind Wrathing and Hero Powering. I don't mind double Wrathing. I want to just take care of something here. Okay, he chooses to Swipe.
Swipe allows him to play Violet Teacher plus Wrath next turn, or 4-drop plus Wrath, regardless of what it is. So even though the swipe isn't really taking out much, I understand why he went for it. But his plan didn't account for... I'm going to say it in an alternative way. 14 worth of stats for 4 mana. That makes it sound even more frightening.
I mean, to be fair, the Flaming Faces is not the first minion to ever have that stat line across its mana.
Eerie Statue?
Yeah, the Eerie Statue, for example.
Also, there's one more. Come back.
Okay.
Come back to me later, Dan.
All right, DJ. Babblebox cycling the Wrath, wondering if he wants to just innervate out another Wrath as well. Perhaps cycling that too, so that way he can just improve the context of his hand. If he's Wrathing, he's just hoping that his opponent doesn't trade well into it, but that's a little bit optimistic if your opponent just doesn't either taunt up or remove it through Lava Burst. He's actually a lot of options here. I kind of like the Lava Burst, the 3-5, and then use one of the 1-2s, or kill off the 1-1 tokens with the 1-2, because he already used 2 Wraths in a swipe.
The likelihood that he has removal is pretty low. I mean, a Living Roots would get it done, but... again, that your opponent will only have 3 cards going into the next turn. If one of those is a Living Roots, overall their hand quality is very low, and it means that your second Flame with Faceless, which will probably come down next turn,
right? Because you would have enough mana for exactly that.
This is going to have almost 0 outs, and this is.
So he's giving up his Faceless, and then how does Babblebox deal with this?
This is interesting.
Oh, he's got the mold. Okay, so based off the line that we suggested, I think Babblebox would have punished I Kill You with the mulch. Hard to say, though, because he still had to deal with this first Flameleaf Faceless as well.
Yeah.
I think he's tempted to use it, though.
I'm wondering if I Kill You is trying to plan ahead. He will have 5 mana going into the next turn, so maybe he doesn't want to play Flameleaf Faceless. Maybe he wants to tap and play Feral Spirits and hide the Flame Tectonic behind. Or he wants to give 2... high priority kill targets, maybe, because Flamethrower Totem can be a high priority kill target in a lot of situations.
It gives him flexibility to play Doomhammer if he draws it.
That's true, but he already has strong plays, so it feels like he doesn't really need to fish for a Doomhammer and hope for it when he already has strong plays to make. It's interesting. And so Babblebox is just going to go ahead and draw, picks up some pretty big stuff
right
by Nyxia.
He also could be anticipating what his opponent would do on 7 mana, and Ancient of War is usually the most common line of play, and if he's able to contest that reasonably well, then he felt comfortable. Now I Kill You, if he plays his Flamey Faceless, he is going to start falling behind, and then Druid can make the comeback.
I kind of like with all the single target removal spells gone to try and go wide here and just play the second Flame Tongue and play both Feral Spirits. He'd still be left with going into turn 7, so he'd have 5 mana again next turn with 2 overloaded crystals, so he could tap plus Lava Burst, or he'd still have a lot of flexibility, but wants to go ahead and tap. I guess the second Flame Tongue, the only thing it manages to do is push an extra 2 damage.
Right.
It doesn't really put too much more power on the board. You could just play the Flame Tongue Totem next turn and sort of get the same effect, but...
I agree a lot with this play. I think I Kill You on the right track here. Now that he picked up 2 Lava Bursts, that's also a ton of damage. He can just push it out with the 6 damage on board already, and that's 20 damage. If he doesn't mulch, he's dead. No, is he dead either way?
Well, he only has 5 mana crystals next turn.
So oh, you're right. You're right.
He
you're
can't
right,
play
you're
double
right,
lava burst.
He can't lava burst.
But the thing is, can he stabilize over the two turns that I kill you is going to heal him?
Dude, he's really happy to see that because now the mulch is gone. And well, that's a funny card, Dreadscale. Ends up dealing with the Violet Teacher tokens very well. Imagine that.
All right, so you're just going to build up as big of a board as possible while still keeping enough mana to play those double lava bursts next turn. We're starting to get close to the end. Babblebox sort of needs a miracle here.
Yeah, Nyaoxaron's not in his hand. He's got Onyxia, the Daughter of Deathwing, but that's just the Daughter of Death, actually, because you just die to whatever damage your opponent generates for three. And he's got more copies of more tokens and more things to summon them. So Babblebox looks like he is out of options. He needs to reach down into that box and pull out an answer.
Yeah, and that answer is not a babble, whatever that may be.
Doesn't make sense, but yeah. It's at this point, Babblebox actually is just dead, I think. He can't really answer what's on board. He's just going to die to these double lava bursts. And Aikyu has planned out his mana over the past couple turns just to accommodate this very specific moment. So Babblebox is praying. I think he's going to play Onyxia and pray. But no one's listening, Babblebox, because Aikyu is about to stay true to his name. With a fist pump, Aikyu is going to the Spring Championship once as he's able to use his lava burst and book his ticket. Congratulations.
Dude, you can see he's very, very happy there. And yeah, Summer Championship.
Did I say Spring Championship? Yeah. My bad. The Summer Championship. Aikyu is going to the Summer Championship. Congratulations. A job well done as he's able to take down his opponent. And it was a pretty grueling series, all things considering. Five games going the entire distance. And a job well done to our Polish player.
It seemed like Babblebox was just trying to pick up some like scrappy wins here and there. And I don't know. I said that his weakness might be his tech cards. Who knows how much of an effect they played? Who knows if he'd had a lightning storm in his shaman, if he would have drawn it in time, or if that acidic swamp ooze was a different card. It's almost impossible to tell, but I gave Aikyu an edge at the beginning, and he prevailed just barely.
Yeah, a job well done. And I know that the Polish community is actually very active. And like I mentioned before, they're very proud and they stick together and they practice a lot. They do remind me in a lot of ways of the French community in so many facets. So it makes me feel very good to see that the Polish community does have the representative for this season.
We also have a representative from France as well, with Diz Demon, who has a couple of French teammates and also is a big part of the French community as well. So we didn't get to have one last season, I believe, but we had TARS in winter. So that's why Europe is sort of special. You talked about it earlier, being able to have representation from so many different places.
Yep.
North America's just boop right there.
It's just the USA.
Yeah, right
is
there.
Is that what you're saying, TJ?
And South America, too.
South America. And there's also Canada.
Yeah, there was actually some South Africans playing in the preliminary.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. We want to see more of that as well. Mm-hmm. Congratulations to our winner. Let's head over to Sato for a few words with our winners.
Thank you, Dan. Yeah, great performance from Aikyu booking his spot, but what a heartbreaker for Babblebox. He was one game off, went all the way through the upper bracket, and then went 0-2 from that position to be dropped out. But the real story here is Aikyu booking his spot, and we do have him standing by on Skype, so let's catch a few words with him. Aikyu, can you hear me, buddy?
Yeah, okay, Soto.
Awesome. So you must be over the moon right now. We saw your moment of celebration there at the end, but why don't you just tell us in your own words exactly what this means to you?
I've been so many times so close to advancing to big LAN tournament, like Gfinity, Via Game, IEM Katowice last year, and it was like one round off always, so I was always close, and in spring prelims I was like top 24, so it means a lot to me that it finally happened and I can show my skills and just perform on the big stage.
That's awesome. Yeah, I was saying to some of the guys backstage that you're a name that, like, I've personally, I think I've run into you in, like, qualifiers for big tournaments. I've played you on ladder a few times. Yeah. So, like, you've always been a guy that's been around for me as well. So I'm happy to see you do very well. But can you also tell us a little bit about, like, the Polish community and how you function? Because obviously I've been at a ton of events with Nimsz, and he never shuts up about you guys. Like, he's always bigging up his Polish players. So can you just describe to us, like, how well the Polish scene works together?
Yeah, Nimsz is awesome. He's like always the most helpful guy. He's trying to do a lot of stuff for us. He always tries to promote us. Mm-hmm. But we have a few big streamers that average like 3K viewers, 2K viewers. So the Polish community is really big. We maybe didn't show our skills on the big stage because we kind of lack of good teams that can support us and send to big events. But recently we attended Dreamhack Valencia, a few of us, and we had pretty okay results there, and we hope to do it more in the future. And we had Loyon, obviously, in spring prelims, like the championships. So I feel like Polish community is just starting to show our skill, and we'll just continue to do it in the future.
Awesome. Just a quick question about your lineup before I let you go. I guess the interesting point in your lineup is your warrior list with Sogoth the Slytherin there, control warrior, but we've been seeing warrior get banned pretty consistently. So how much have you actually got to play that warrior, and how has it performed for you off stream?
I played I played it only once.
Okay.
And it went 1-0. Everyone was so scared of it, and I made my lineup to beat aggressive decks, like the meta decks, the Zoo, Shaman. Maybe three of my decks are the meta decks, and the warrior was doing really well against those decks in the practice. And I didn't fight, I mean, other decks that were supposed to counter the meta decks weren't performing that well for me. Okay. So I decided to just go with Zoo, the Druid, and the Shaman. And warrior was like really good against those three decks. So everyone was scared of it, and I guess they were correct to do it.
Awesome. Well, anyway, I will let you go. I'm sure you want to get off and celebrate now. So congratulations,
yeah,
and I'll see you here for the championship. So well played.
Yeah, looking forward to that. Thanks a lot.
So there we have it. IQLU has booked his spot, but we still have some spots left to fight for. And our next game that we are going to see on stream will be Tvist versus 6-0. They have had fairly similar runs through the tournament. Both have to play six games to get here. Some notable names, of course. Dr. Hippie was vanquishing Tvist to book his spot there in the championship, whereas 6-0 has taken out names like Silvername and Babblebox, who you saw there being defeated. So the most important thing about this matchup coming up, though, in terms of us as the cast, is that 6-0 is the one remaining name left on our prediction board, as unfortunately Frodan's pick in Pavel has been eliminated from the tournament. So I have great pleasure in eliminating Frodan from the caster competition, which means there is one man left standing, the man, the myth, the legend, that is Neil Bond. And joining Neil Lorinda Bond at the desk to talk you through this next game is Raven.